Hello, hello, welcome to Quackalope, and I'm surrounded by games. Now, the rest of my apartment basically looks like this, so this is fairly comfortable, but today I'm going to be going over my Gen Con haul. Now, all the games you see around me are not all the games I personally brought home. I had a friend who was working the convention as well. He was kind enough to allow me to take a few of the games that he was excited about back to the studio so I could show off kind of a nice collection. So about 50% of these games are games that I'll be covering on my channel, and the other half of them are games I just wanted to show off because one of my good friends is really excited about them. Whatever the case, let's go ahead and dive into this pile of games. This video is going to be a board game haul video. I'll give you a quick breakdown on what the games are, followed by some really nice kind of board game B-roll, just showing off the components, what the games look like, the artwork, and then you can find out more information on your own, whether a game sparks your interest, sounds like something you'd have fun playing, or just visually seems to stand out to you. I'll have links in the description of this video to locations where you can find out more about the game, purchase the game if it's something you want to pick up, and you can always leave a comment in the comment section down below asking any questions or kind of asking for my thoughts or final take on a game. Along with that, a lot of these games will be eventually featured on my channel. So if there's something here you really want to see, you know, us do a gameplay of or a full review of or even a thorough unboxing, please let me know. I'm always happy to accommodate what people are asking for. Whatever the case, let's go ahead and dive in. So starting off here is going to be the one right next to me, which is Trogdor the Board Game. This is a cooperative, semi-cooperative game where you're trying to pillage the countryside, directing Trogdor across the village, across the landscape, setting things on fire. It seems like a fairly lightweight, silly, cooperative or semi-cooperative game. If you're a fan of Homestar Runner or Trogdor, if you know anything about that kind of internet culture that's around this game, this might be something that you want to take a closer look at. I was excited when it came out on Kickstarter a while back. One of my friends backed it. I was able to pick up a copy here at Gen Con, but it still looks like it'll be a little ridiculous and probably a lot of fun. Oh, set this down into the side. Next, I'm gonna swing over to a few of Tuesday Night Games. Oh, reach around the edge there. They sent me home with a few of their other products. Now, if you saw my Origins video, you saw Two Rooms and a Boom. That's probably their biggest, kind of, their most well-known game that they've put out. But now, I also have Russian Roulette, That's Not Lemonade, and the newest publication in the Mothership role-playing system, along with a fan-created kind of gear grid or systems or lore or tables. They were kind enough to send me home with all these products so I could take a closer look at them. I was able to demo both of these, and I hope to have some RPG gameplay coming down the road on the channel as soon as possible. Russian Roulette is a really fun push your luck slash bluffing game where you're either loading your gun or not loading your gun and cycling through cards as you play the game. Other people can call you out, determining whether or not they think there really is a bullet in the chamber. And if there is, you'll score some points. If there isn't, you'll be called out for being a fraud or cheating. You're doing your very best to cheat your way to victory. Another interesting thing about Russian Roulette, and actually That's Not Lemonade as well, is they're games where people can come, go, leave, enter. They're kind of open table games. So if you're sitting around at an event space or just at a friend's house, these are both games that are perfect for kind of a party environment where some people are going to be coming and going. They don't require you to maintain constant focus for a perpetual amount of time. That's Not Lemonade is a full-on pressure luck game where you're just drawing cards and the odds are increasingly getting worse. You're trying to see if you can be luckier than the guy next to you. And then the Mothership RPG series is an award-winning kind of dark fantasy or space-based RPG game. It's well known for the lore and tables that it sets up. It has really, really lovely artwork throughout it. I'm really excited to give this specific chapter a closer look, but also just the core game as a whole. I'll set these over to the side and we'll continue cycling. I'm gonna reach around to the front here and grab Folded Wishes by B&B Games. Now, this is a prototype, an early prototype game that will be coming to publication here soon. They were kind enough to send me home with one of the few prototypes that they had. This is an abstract strategy game where you're trying to move tiles across the board to create patterns, sort of in the vein of origami. Along with that, every single box is going to contain a nice little pad of origami with instructions for how to build the pieces that you're playing with. It's aesthetically lovely and I think is a really nice abstract strategy game. So if you like games in the vein of Azul or Shobu, those are other abstract strategy games, this might be one you want to keep an eye on for when it comes to full print. And I have to go to the top here to talk about one of my favorite games ever. As this pile decreases, you'll see a wall of brown kind of appear behind me on one of my bookshelves. That is a pile of Kingdom Death boxes. And in front of me, I have the new releases or new content for the Kingdom Death series. I have a few just resin models here, along with two new plastic models. These are gonna come with a story event or some gear card. We have the Ringtail Vixen here, and we have the Sword Hunter. I also have two larger boxes. I have the Echoes of Death 2. They released package 1 back at Gen Con a year ago, and this year they released number 2, which is gonna come with 4 plastic models, along with an updated strain system card, which is sort of a take on a legacy element in a large campaign game like Kingdom Death. The strain system is basically the way the settlements that don't contain human history impact the environment that you're playing in. So if they step on a flower or maybe habitate near a specific body of water or pond or mess with a creature, they change the environment just a little bit. So the next people that come and settle there or your next campaign will be impacted and have those memories and that storyline carried along. But the coolest thing, the biggest thing that Kingdom Death released at Gen Con 2019 is the Vignette of Death, the White Gigalion. This is the very first time Kingdom Death has released a one-off campaign system. So, this is a self-contained showdown event. So instead of playing a full campaign, you have predetermined gear grids, you have survivors, you have a showdown ready to go. You're able to pull this out and play one contained session. If you win, this then becomes a huntable creature during your longer campaigns. So, this is a great way to introduce people to the brutality of Kingdom Death and a little bit of the late game content without committing them to a 40, 50, 60 hour campaign. But if you're able to defeat the Gigalion, you're then able to incorporate it into your longer campaign sessions to vary up some of the creatures that you're fighting. I'm really excited about this. I will be having gameplay of this coming out hopefully within the next week. Keep your eyes out for it. I really hope that Kingdom Death releases some more of these vignettes down the road. That being said, you still do need the core Kingdom Death game in order to play this. This is a kind of mini or micro expansion. Oh, set these down. Next, I'll lessen this stack just a little bit so you can start to see that pile of brown. And here we have Sorcerer. Sorcerer is a really incredible deck construction game where you're taking a few different types of cards and building a character out of it. So in this game, you're gonna have 3 separated decks that'll combine into one sorcerer who you'll be playing as, trying to conquer different regions and send their kind of bad guys out onto the field. The thing that I think Sorcerer does that makes it unique from other deck construction games is that the way those 3 decks combine are varied and manageable, but they also do a really incredible job at combining in a way that makes you feel like you're playing a real character. So you have a sorcerer, kind of the personality, you have their house where they learn their skills, and their archetype or their magic type. And all 3 of those combine into a really interesting self-contained character. If you like deck building or deck construction games, this is one that I would highly recommend taking a closer look at. Along with that, as you can see in the B-roll footage, the artwork in this game is breathtaking. Sorcerer is published by White Wizard Games, and it's not the only White Wizard Games that I have here with me. I also have Star Realms and Hero Realms. Now these are going to be your more traditional deck building game. Whereas Sorcerer is a deck construction game where you're taking a few different decks and putting them together to form your sorcerer, and you'll be playing that through the entire session. Hero Realms and Star Realms are takes on a deck building game, where you have an amount of coin, an amount of damage. You start off with a fairly weak tribe, and you have kind of a bipool or a marketplace in the center of the table. Both you and your opponent will be playing cards that give you the ability to change up or customize your decks based on what you're trying to accomplish. All of the marketplace cards will be available to both of you until someone has purchased them, and you kind of battle with each other until you're able to take the opponent's health down to zero. If you're into deck building games such as Clank or Terrors of London, these are really nice deck building games. They have a strong community around them, and I know White Wizard Games has put a lot into designing expansions and variations, so both Hero Realms and Star Realms have a lot of community support. So if you like deck building games, I'd say take a closer look at these. I'm gonna set all of these down to the side. Oh. And we're not quite there yet, but we're making it through. I appreciate you still being here because we have a lot of great games to talk about. We have Tiny Epic Defenders. Now, these are two games from Gameling Games. These are tiny little cooperative or solo-based games where you're trying to defend a region from a big baddie. There's a series of fantasy-based creatures who are descending upon kind of the Defender's realm, and you're playing a hero with attachable items and gear. It's a mini version of any sort of epic fantasy that you'd go through. You're moving across these cards trying to keep your home protected until you can finally have an epic showdown with the big bad and hopefully defeat them before they destroy the realm. If you know anything about the Tiny Epic series, you know that these boxes might be small, but all of their games pack a pretty big punch, depending on what type of games you like. If you like solo or cooperative games based in a fantasy realm, and you want something that comes in a small package but packs a little bit more of a punch, give Tiny Epic Defenders a closer look. I'm excited to bring these to my channel here soon. Up next, we have the Quacks of Quedlinburg's new expansion, The Herb Witches. Now, there were only a limited number of copies of these at Gen Con, and I have to say, this is not my copy, sadly. This is my friend's copy, but we were able to break it out and play it. We'll be having some gameplay of that. If it's not already on the channel, we will be having some gameplay of this coming onto the channel soon. And I really like this expansion. It introduces a few more variations of the ingredients that you're adding and the effects that they have. It adds three more zones or three more actions that you can choose to take throughout the course of the game that change up or manipulate the strategy a little bit more. And then on top of that, it adds another ingredient and an extra player. So if you like The Quacks of Quedlinburg by North Star Games, I would say The Herb Witches is almost an essential expansion. For me, it doesn't change the game so drastically that it makes it an entirely new game. Instead, it improves and accentuates what I already love about Quacks, and I would say adds a little bit more strategy to a game that can sometimes feel a little luck-based. It's a really, really good bag builder, and this expansion, once I get my own copy, is going to live in my Quacks box. It's just gonna become part of the way that I play the game. I'm gonna set this down to the side. Oh, like always, I'm gonna pull over from the top here, and this might seem a little weird. In fact, this is not a board game. Instead, this is the modular board for Scythe, and a few of the Kickstarter or fan-created cards for Scythe. I have Scythe on the game shelf there behind me. It's one of the games that my friends and I really, really love. It's a kind of tactical region control or territory control game with a threat of war kind of always looming over the edges of the board. So because we already own basically everything, this modular board was available at Gen Con and I had to pick it up. It just adds another bit of variation to a game that we try to get to the table, you know, once every few weeks or so. I forgot to mention that I have this nice little playmat for Hero Realms. I'm sure you saw some B-roll of it, but I thought I'd mention it before, you know, I dive into something else. Next, we have The Curse of Barnacle Bay, and this is easily the largest and heaviest game that I came home from Gen Con with. This is a choose-your-own-adventure dungeon crawl miniatures game, and I'm sure in the B-roll that you're seeing all of these epic kind of fish hybrid creatures. There's a bear shark, there's some like fish archers, it's a whole mix and kind of world of lore. The really interesting thing that this game does is it has a choose-your-own-adventure sort of campaign system where you can play single one-off scenarios, but it also has kind of a mid-ranged nine-game in-game campaign system where you're able to see a variety of the lore and content, but not ever see it all. So you have quite a few opportunities to dive back into this game while still experiencing or coming across things that you had never seen before by choosing different outcomes, getting different story events, gear cards, leveling your characters up in different ways. I was able to demo this at Origins. I was able to pick up a copy at Gen Con. This is one that I will be bringing to the channel, doing some gameplay, possibly doing a full review. I'm really excited to dive into this. If you know anything about my channel and what I personally really enjoy, story-driven miniature games is right up my alley. So if this sounds like your style of game, keep an eye out for some content or just go, you know, pick it up for yourself. I'm gonna set this down to the side. This one's heavy. That's a heavy game. Next, I have Unfair by Good Games Publishing, and the newest part of Unfair is going to be the Unfair expansion, the Alien B-Movie Dinosaur Western, which sounds incredible. Unfair is a card-driven tableau building game where you're trying to construct the best amusement park you can while a bunch of sort of weird or horrific things are happening across the rest of the game state. There's cards that you can play that either benefit you or cause chaos for everyone else and everyone else's amusement parks. For me, I really like the artwork, I like the theme. I grew up playing the Sims Tycoon style games, and so this was one that I really wanted to take a closer look at. I'm excited to be able to dive into it. From what I've seen online doing the research before I picked up this game, it seems like a game that has a lot of depth to it. It can be a little bit complicated to play, but if you like tableau builders, if you like the theme and the style of this game, I'd say give this one a closer look. And just because I messed it up at the very start, the expansion fits in with the cover. Isn't that lovely? This is a game with a lot of depth and variability. I will be having more content coming out on the channel as soon as possible. All right, Good Games Publishing. Oh, we're gonna have to set you to the side. Now, instead of a pile on the table, I literally just have a pile building right next to me here. Soon I'll have armrests, which is kind of exciting. The next thing I want to take a look at is Tyler Sigmund's Crows. This is going to be another abstract, kind of thematic abstract game where you have this grid of tiles on the board and crows that are habitating and spreading across the board. And you're doing everything you can to place your monument in an area that controls or manipulates where those crows end up, trying to collect as many crows as you can. Now, I say it's a thematic abstract game. I mean, it really is a abstract strategy game in the same vein of some of the others that I've mentioned. The reason I say it's thematic is because the artwork, the style, you know, even the little meeple crows that it comes with are just really, really, really nice. So when you're playing the game, you really get sucked into kind of this ambient world. It makes me think of like Edgar Allan Poe's kind of the raven just squawking kind of in a bleak and dreary area. This is one of the games that my friend picked up. So far, he swears by it. I'm excited to play it myself, and if you like abstract strategy games, I'd say give it a quick Google. The next game I have over here as we deplete this half of the table is Mega City Oceania. This is a strategical dexterity game where you're trying to build the most beautiful city possible. So the really interesting thing about this game is you're going to be playing tiles that give you the instructions or the design specifications for these buildings that you have to construct. But there's no time off during this game, so while other people are taking their turns and figuring out where they're going to put their tiles to design the most beautiful city, you're over on your own side trying to get glass and concrete to balance perfectly so that it's a certain amount of inches tall or has the right components. Maybe it has a kind of bridge crossing two beams, this weird little dexterity game that you're playing. And then when it comes back around to your turn, you have to then manipulate and move that constructed building onto your city grid or onto your location so that you can score the most victory points possible. It's a really interesting take on a dexterity system with a nice amount of strategy to it. If you like dexterity games but you want a little bit more depth to them than average, I'd say this was one to take a closer look at. Move this off to the side. Like I said, that pile is just growing. And we're going to deplete this half of the table by taking a look at The Menace Among Us. This is a smirk and dagger game. This is a really interesting hidden identity or hidden agenda game. It's a card-driven game that can play within about 60 minutes once you're really into the swing of things. And instead of being more of a role-playing game where you're trying to trick people by your personality and how you're reacting to things, it's one of those games where the actions that you take throughout the game sequence reveal or don't reveal who you are and what sort of game you're playing. As the title says, there is going to be a menace around the game board. So you're going to have 4 to 8 people trying to keep the oxygen levels in this spaceship stable so that everyone doesn't, you know, suffocate. And there's going to be 1 or 2 different menace who exist at the game state, depending on how many people are playing, who would really prefer to see those oxygen levels drop. And as you're doing things throughout the course of the game, such as healing a fellow companion or upgrading something or fixing something, every action you take will start to deplete the oxygen. So I could be helping you by healing you, or I could be hurting the group as a whole. It's a really interesting hidden agenda game that not only I picked up, but also my friend picked up. So we came home with 2 copies of this. I'm really excited to get it to the table, to play it, to possibly bring some gameplay or certainly a full review and coverage of this to the channel soon. Now, the last 3 games that I have next to me are all games that my friend brought home. So let's take a quick look at them as well. We have Reavers of Midgard, which is probably the heaviest Euro-style game that I brought home from Gen Con this year. It is a Euro-style worker placement game where you're kind of building up your own raiding party or building up your own civilization to be the most successful at that by the end of the game. One of the standout elements of this game is that it can either be a Champions of Midgard-style dice roller, where you see what you get and then plan out your moves based on that, or it can be more of a Euro-style match symbols, kind of position your dice exactly how you want throughout the game. So if you enjoy a kind of tactical dice roller game, might fit you. If you enjoy a heavier Euro-style control all the elements as much as possible, it also might fit you. Thematically, story-wise, kind of art book-wise, it's a really, really lovely game with a lot of depth and choice throughout it. This is one of the games that my friend was really excited to bring home with him. It kind of fits both of our gaming groups with that Euro-style gameplay and that dice-chucking gameplay. I'm on more of the strategic Euro side. He's on more of the I just kind of want to see what I get side of the game. So he's really excited to own and play it, and I'm excited to give it a look as well. Let's swing over here to Foodies. Oh! If I can, you know, set that package down. Foodies is a Machikoro style game where everyone around the table is going to be rolling a die, and then everyone else who didn't roll that die will be able to activate whatever die face that shows up. You're trying to design your personal food court to be the best food court possible, and you'll do that by playing tiles on your board that respond or react to certain die faces throughout the game. So as other players roll their die and you activate the die that was just rolled, your tiles will bounce off of each other, and you'll have this kind of sequencing effect on the tiles that you've played. If you like Machikoro, this is kind of another in line that hits that same type of gameplay with a really, really lovely theme and art style. So this might be one worth checking out. Set this down, and I believe we're on to our very last game, other than the Kingdom Death t-shirt that I'm wearing, because, you know, I have to represent a little bit. Here we have Sabotage. An important thing to note, this is the first big box game by Tim Fowers. This is a team versus team hidden movement game where you have the spies and the villains, each trying to infiltrate this base to either plant bombs or de-neutralize bombs or steal something. I'm not exactly sure how the lore lines up, but one thing that I do know is that the game's lovely and I've heard really good things about it. Now, like I said, this is one of the games that my friend brought home. This is a team versus team hidden agenda game. This game box actually folds out into a big split screen that divides the two parties. If you're interested in kind of the lore or the theme of the game, it is a very classic spies versus villains archetype. So you're going to be rolling dice, resolving those dice to either deneutralize a bomb or plant something or steal something. It's that head-to-head competition that a lot of these kind of hidden agenda team versus team games do really well. This is the newest game in that kind of line of games, and this is a large reason why I had to get this video filmed as quickly as possible, because my friend wants to take it home and play it, and as you can see, we haven't opened it yet. Whatever the case, if you like those team versus team games, if you like hidden movement games, I'd say give this one a really close look. This is the first time Tim Fowers has done miniatures in their game, and they came out really nice and chunky. The way this box kind of opens up and splits the game state, just everything about the production quality on this game is really, really nice. I'm gonna set this to the side so that I have a perfectly blank table, and thank you for sticking with us. We covered a lot of games, and I had a really fantastic time at Gen Con. I was able to meet a lot of you there, along with some publishers and designers and other media creators that I look up to. If you've made it to this point in the video, I'd really appreciate it if you'd, you know, leave a comment in the comment section down below talking about your Gen Con experience or what games you brought home that maybe I didn't cover here. Whatever the case, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. It's that pitch that we always have to do at the end of our videos, but that's because we want to be able to continue creating content, and we don't want you to miss it. Whatever you do, though, remember to do the important thing. Get out and play some games, and I'll see you next time. Thank you.